So a few things. Actually, Laura and Vanessa are helping me out this week, and they are going to be passing out some cards down the aisles. So they're going to come out now. Part of this is because you will get to vote. I will be asking you, let's call them pop quizzes. So I'll be asking you some questions throughout my lectures, and I'll need you to hold up the cards so I can see, you know, do you think answer A is correct? Did you actually ever take a class in biostatistics? Yeah, I know it's scary stuff, but I think you'll be happy by the time we get to the final examination that we did it. Also, if you think of questions while we're talking, go ahead and write those down. You can pass them to Laura, you can pass them to Vanessa, you can pass them to any of the faculty, and we will try to cover all of those questions during the course. So you can ask us at lunch, but sometimes people prefer to pass their questions off to the side. Whatever works for you will work for us. As Dr. Gallen and others have said, what we really want to happen this week is that we see a lot of building of friendships, a lot of networking, but also we want to make sure that when you come away, oh, thank you so very much, that when you come away at the end of this week, that you have a much stronger understanding of clinical research and how to do your own jobs and how to train and teach other folks. So this is a real learning experience. I also want to give a little bit of warning. And that is that many folks have said kind of Monday and Tuesday, they feel a little lost. So it's okay. I just want to let you know now it's okay. Because by Wednesday, the material is going to start falling into place. You're going to kind of know what's going on. By Wednesday night, it will probably all start to make sense. If it's Thursday afternoon, Thursday at lunch, so Thursday right after lunch, we're going to do something called reporting results. And I think that will actually bring a lot of these elements together for you. But if you finish that lecture and you're really lost, you need to come let me know very quickly. So Thursday night, what I'll be doing is trying to pull together summaries and trying to answer all those last questions so that you all are in a great position for your exam on Friday afternoon. You know, I'd be very happy if everybody passes their exam. So think about it that way. You know, if you get a little lost, a lot of this material is fairly new. So it's okay. It's okay to not quite understand it. If you knew everything already, you wouldn't need to be here. I've been sitting in this course for more than 6 different times, and I learn something every single time I'm here. So this is a great place to be. How many of y'all actually use social media in any way, like Facebook or Twitter or something like that? Yeah, if you have those cards, raise them up. This is a good explanation. So how many of y'all use Facebook? How many of y'all use Twitter? How many of y'all use something else? All right, what do you use, the lady in blue? So, I have mine. Thanks. All right, the reason I ask, how many of y'all use it in your clinical research? Nobody. All right, so that is actually something that where I work at the NIH, at the National Center for Complementary Alternative Medicine, we actually use a lot of social media not only to actually bring people into our research studies, but to also send out the results of our research studies and to have dialogues with a lot of our patients and a lot of providers in order to learn about new places and ways that we may need to address research questions. So just something to think about as we are moving through this week. And so if you decide to live tweet my lectures, that's fine. I'll give you my Twitter handle if you want, and you can tag me and tell me how good or bad that I am. So we are going to go until noon when we have lunch. Like I said, I am the bad person who forgot to plan the break-in for today, but you'll have them everywhere else. So we're going to start with this overview of clinical study design. All right, this is where our voting begins. How many people in here have taken a course similar to this in the past? Raise your card up. All right, some of y'all have, good portion. How many folks have ever taken at least one class in biostatistics, epidemiology, or something to do with research design? All right, basically everybody, great. How many of you all have had, we'll skip down, how many of you have a degree? Biostatistics, epidemiology, something like that. All right, a couple of folks, good. That's okay, that means you can help me answer questions, thanks. So how many folks know what logistic regression is? And if I gave you a computer, your favorite statistical software, and some data that you could actually do a logistic regression? Okay, handful more people than have the degree raise their hands, good. How many folks have actually had to design a research study, let's say within the last year? How many of y'all are actively involved in running studies? Doing data analyses all by yourself? Okay, great. So in the last year, how many of y'all have actually read a research protocol? Okay, most of you. How many folks have read a journal article? Yeah. How many of y'all have read about medical research in just general literature, whether it was online or a newspaper, heard it on a newscast? And so there are a lot of different people who are in this course. There are a lot of people in this room. Some of us, this is going to be a fairly early introduction, although not for the vast majority, so that is good news for me. And a lot of what we're going to do, though, there's still a wide variety. Some folks are really advanced or not. So I'm going to focus in many of my lectures on kind of the tricks, the tips, the concepts that come up, not necessarily on what you're going to learn in a standard classroom. So there will be some standard classroom learning, but a lot of this is the type of stuff that helps my investigators on a regular basis, so I'm going to pass it all along to you. The general objective that I tend to have is that I want everybody to be a better consumer of medical and scientific literature when you leave here on Friday. I'm also hoping that you're going to be able to have enhanced conversations inside your research teams, and in particular with your study statisticians and epidemiologists. It's like becoming multilingual. We have to be able to talk to each other. So it's really, really easy to write, kind of that you're going to do this randomized, double-blind, controlled, parallel arm design with an intent to treat analysis. And if you don't know what those words mean, don't worry, you will by Wednesday. But this is something, I see this written in protocols all the time. My office oversees over 100 clinical protocols at any given point in time. And I see people write this down, and then they can't implement it. They can't actually make it work. And part of what all of us are going to try to talk to you about is how to make it work. It's not just the fancy idea, it's execution of the study. So we're going to be able to, by the end of this morning, hopefully, identify some study designs used in clinical studies, epidemiology, public health research. Most of this you won't actually know till the end of the day, but we're going to start off this morning. I'm also going to talk a little bit about masking or blinding studies. So I used to work with some folks at the National Eye Institute in the United States. They do not like it when you say you're going to blind people. They prefer it to say masked. But then other people say nobody since 1970 has talked about masked studies. So whatever your field is, choose the word that makes you happy. I'm going to talk to you about choosing interventions and comparison groups and what you may or may not be able to find out from those. And that is actually going to be a theme throughout several lectures. When you look at those chapters, which should have been available to you on the secure site, most of the material for today's lecture is going to be on chapters 19 and 29 of the third edition of our textbook. So where are we going to start? Several years ago, when I was at the University of Washington, someone came up to me and said, my country has now given me a large amount of money. Cervical cancer is a huge killer of young women. And what we want to do is go through and test everybody, because it makes sense. Cervical cancer, you know what you do. You give everybody a pap smear. It's a pretty straightforward thing. You go look. If you see something on the pap, you go in. You can take care of this really easy. Look for the dysplasia. Eradicate it. You're done. So they set up a program. They were going to go to every single tiny village, every place throughout the country, and they thought that they could, in fact, test all women every 2 to 3 years. Except they ran into a problem. Problem number one, a lot of men in some parts of this country had absolutely no desire for anybody to touch their wives. They didn't even want to think that anything existed from the waist down. Yes, somebody's familiar with this phenomena. So we have that problem. We also have the problem that it's very hard to get to many of these places. So what they realized was they had to go in, do the testing, get the test results, and do any type of intervention that they needed to do on site while they were there, because there was no going back and forth. Everything had to be done then. And so they said, well, we think we have now an all-female team, which seemed to be more acceptable. They had more liaisons. They were doing more and more work culturally in a lot of communities. But then they realized that they would go through, some women were menstruating, you tend to not do a pap smear then, not a big deal, I'm gonna pick them up, this is a slow-growing disease. Except when the problem came up that we had, that they were menstruating the second time they came through. So now you've got 6 years that are going by, and that was considered unacceptable. So what are we gonna do? What they wanted to do was try to clean the cervix with essentially vinegar. They wanted to clean the cervix and then do the pap smear. So there are a lot of questions that come up. You don't know if that pap smear is actually gonna have the same type of test results if you've cleaned the cervix with vinegar than if you haven't. What you also don't know is, should you clean all the cervixes with vinegar, even if they aren't menstruating or not? So what do you have? What they really need is something called a diagnostic biomarker. What they wanted to do was have a test that had something called high negative predictive value. So if I test somebody and it says they are negative, I'm pretty sure they don't have cervical cancer. I don't have to worry about them for a few years. They needed something super low cost because they're trying to roll it out across their entire country. And they need something fast. It can't go to some specialized lab. They were in places, there's not very much electricity. There's not a lot of water. There's a whole bunch of other issues going on. And I've got to be able to get accurate test results very quickly and then be able to deal with any dysplasias that we see and move on to the next town. So we have a timetable for treatment that's also working into this whole thing. So this is the type of question that I get. So while Paul and I are gonna talk a lot about hypothesis testing and creating testable hypotheses, when people tend to come to us, it's with more of a story. And then you're trying to figure out all the different questions that need to be answered in order to try to move health and science forward. She had a lot of different questions that really we could answer. This is true for a lot of different types of things. So whether it's cardiovascular disease, whether it is infectious diseases, whether you're trying to look at new ways to collect data, methods that you are going to do it. So part of what we're talking about and part of this research week is actually moving from teleform into more electronic data collection forms, so electronic case report forms. And as you're doing that, are you going to change the data that's being collected? Are you going to end up, just by the way you're collecting data, changing the outcomes of the study? Now, I will say that we've actually done a lot of studies inside the United States on these issues, and several of my friends have done them in Europe also. We don't find any differences in many of these modes of administration. But one of the studies that I ran, actually when people called on the phone, or if they came and filled out items in person, it went up and down. You could tell exactly which month they were in person and which month they were called on the phone. But because I knew the method of administration that they'd given me the data from, I could work that into my analyses and take that into account. So there are a lot of different examples, a lot of very vague questions, and what you have to do as a researcher is take those vague questions and turn them into a very testable study design. So what is your question of interest, and what were the questions of interest for my colleague? Are we trying to interpret work in new populations? In fact, it turned out she was not alone. There were people in several other countries around the world that were having the same type of problem, and it was interesting, almost all of them had decided on vinegar to try to use to clean the cervix. Are you trying to make decisions about an individual case? And this is a big issue that I see, especially for my clinician researchers, where you're trying to go between looking at differences between populations and then between groups in a study and then treating the individual who's physically in front of you. And this can be very different. And so as you are trying to plan your studies, figure out how somebody's going to be able to actionably use the decisions that are coming out of your research. So think about trying to change a population. This is very popular in diabetes management. It's not that we're trying to get people so they don't have diabetes, but we're trying to kind of move that curve. We're trying to actually shift the distribution so that they are healthier, even though everybody may not be healthy. Classically, what we learn about are differences between groups in a study. This is the way almost all of your courses and all the textbooks are set up, is to compare group A to group B. But we also do a lot of times many types of biomarker development, and there are many different types of biomarker development, not just diagnostic, but that's usually the most prominent one, so that will be primarily what I talk about when we go there. How do you develop a new outcome? A good part of my work is developing new outcome measures where we haven't had them before. Is that what you need to do to move the science forward? It's a very different question, a very different set of study designs that have to be used instead of comparing two drugs to each other. Are you trying to establish a level of evidence? Are you trying to evaluate the evidence? So how exactly we're going to do this, how we're going to shift this kind of disease incidence prevalence, what are we looking for here? All of these are very different studies. So in the end, I think it's incredibly important to understand that analysis always follows design. People come up to me and say, you know, well, can't you just analyze my study? Can't you tell me what to do, fill in the blanks? And I used to, in fact, I did for about a year and a half, every single talk I gave, I just titled it, "What is the question?" Because your questions always come first. From your questions, we're going to build the hypotheses that are going to be tested. Based on those hypotheses, we are going to develop an experimental design. The samples all come from that experimental design. The data comes from those samples. Then the analyses are going to happen on the data. You draw conclusions, you usually have more questions, and we circle this whole thing back again. But you want to talk to your statistician early and often. You want those statisticians and epidemiologists in every single one of your group meetings. They should make every lab meeting, every clinic meeting, anything to do with your study. You want to go have coffee with them, because they are going to help you with the guidance and assumptions that are necessary. And I much prefer to talk to my investigators on a regular basis to see how they're thinking. And with that, then I can help them develop those ideas much more quickly and also more efficiently. So what we're going to talk about in the next 70 minutes or so is we're going to talk about a variety of vocabulary words first, just get some general vocabulary. And once everybody gets seated, I've been asked to take a picture, so we're going to do that too. So then I'm going to go through some good study design elements. We're going to talk about those interventions and doses of interventions and some comparisons. We're going to be building on this information all week. If I get to it, we'll get to the conclusions. I don't think I'm going to get to confounding and effect modification, but we'll talk about that sometime this week, even if we don't talk about it today. So what are we going to talk about? Study design taxonomy. You have intervention studies, sometimes called experimental studies. So intervention, I am intervening on the humans or on any element that is in my study. Or observational studies. Observational studies, I am purely looking at people. I am trying not to actually influence the participants in my study when I do an observational study. A longitudinal study. A longitudinal study is like a movie. So I'm going to watch people over a period of time. Whereas a cross-sectional study is a snapshot in time, like the snapshot I'm going to take of everybody in their seats. So that Fred Ognebeni, who's the director of medical education at the clinical center, who works with Dr. Gallen, can see all the people. Fred has been on many of the phone calls trying to plan this event, and they're looking forward to a picture to see everybody here, the fruits of his labor, while he sits back in Bethesda. So cross-sectional is a picture. What is a prospective study? A prospective study is when I look forward in time. I would take baseline information on everybody in this room. I would measure your blood pressure today. And then I would follow you forward and I would measure your blood pressure again on Friday. Then I might measure your blood pressure again in a year. That's a prospective study. A retrospective study is when I look backwards in time and I say, what was your blood pressure a year ago? What was your blood pressure 10 years ago? But think about this. You may not have that information. Maybe you didn't get your blood pressure taken a year ago. So retrospective studies can be very difficult to work on. You have blinded or masked studies or non-blinded or masked studies. Sometimes it's a single blind, which means only one party is actually blinded. Usually that's the participant, but actually for a lot of the studies I work on, we blind the people who are recording the study data. We call them the study assessors. So it is an assessor-blinded study because both the people providing the intervention and the patients in the study actually know what treatment they're getting. While sometimes that is considered an unblinded study, we always want to try to put in some element of blinding into our studies. A double-blind study is when basically everybody is blinded to what intervention group a person is on. So if Dr. Grady, for example, is in the study, she may know that I may have her taking a drug, I may have her taking a placebo, but she does not know which one she is taking, and I don't know which one she is taking. There's somebody who has a key who will know, but in general, none of us do. We have randomized versus non-randomized studies, and we're going to talk a lot about randomization the next several days. So again, what are these two main types of research studies? Observational studies, where our goal is to observe and collect data on the characteristics of interest without influencing the participant, the environment the participants are in, or the disease course. This is really very hard to do. Many times we start poking people to take measurements of them, and you in fact change their environment, you change their disease course. An experimental or investigational or interventional study, many times the researchers are deliberately influencing the course of events. Our goal is in fact to change the course of disease, is to actually influence the participant in some way. That's what you do in an interventional study. And so typically these experimental studies that we do on human beings are referred to either as clinical trials or clinical studies. So what is our ideal study? What is it that everybody holds up as kind of the gold standard that we compare everything to? These are studies that have a treatment arm and a control arm. They have parallel groups, so we're actually running the treatment and the control at the same time. We tend to do something called a superiority test. We assume what we want to test, typically the researcher will say the treatment is better than the control. It is superior than the control. And what you're going to learn is that we're going to say, well, you better watch out, because that control arm may be better than your new treatment arm. Sometimes you're much better off on the control. Prospective study. We expect you to follow people in time, so you decide which way you're going to intervene on them. Are they getting the new treatment? Are they in the control arm? And then you're going to follow them for a period of time. It is double blind. So that means that both the participant and the investigators they are interacting with, neither one of them know if they are receiving the treatment or the control. And it's randomized allocation. So here are a series of studies. I just mentioned them because you're going to notice that throughout the week we're going to talk about all these topics. So I tend to use British Medical Journal or BMJ a lot in my talks because it's open access so everybody can read the articles and I don't have to worry about that. So it's not that I'm promoting them, it's just open access. So this one week in BMJ, they had a systematic review and meta-analysis. We're going to go over those topics this week. We have a researcher-blind, multi-center, randomized, controlled trial. We have a population-based cohort study and a large-scale survey. So the type of information we are going to talk to you about in the next few days, it all is going to be in every single journal that you read. So what are the observational studies? My colleague Jerry Menikoff is going to talk about these extensively in the afternoon, but kind of your main topics. You have case reports. So these are very detailed reports that are going to be taken about a disease, but it's usually just a handful of patients, case series. It may be a single report, something that looks a little odd, or a handful of these reports. That's your report to case series. Then you have cross-sectional studies, and these are prevalent surveys. Again, remember, cross-sectional was that snapshot in time. This is almost like a census. So when I try to look at these cross-sectional or prevalent surveys, I'm going to try to very quickly take an accounting across a large group of people in order to see what they look like. What is everybody's blood pressure today? A case control study, I'm going to take a group of people that actually have a disease, for instance, and try to find a group of people who don't have a disease, and then I'm going to compare them. I want to know what makes them different. But sometimes, merely the types of people I pull up are going to cause differences and not the disease itself. So you have to be careful. Cohort studies tend to be longitudinal, so they're like surveys, except I'm going to gather a group of people and I'm going to follow them over time. We also sometimes do these in the workplace. That's where you can get some of those good retrospective health records, is in the workplace environment. We also do natural history studies, and then there's a special type of study that I'm not going to talk about, I think, much in any of these lectures, but it is in the textbook, and these are ecological studies, and that is when you don't take person-level data, but you actually take data on the population, so you may get it, right, information by state or by country instead of at the individual level, and you do your comparisons from there. What I'm going to focus on this morning is mainly the intervention-based research spectrum. And only a little part of that. So some epidemiology, in fact, is interventional. But usually you see these quasi-experimental studies, these single-arm studies that people do. You also see preclinical studies, some phase zero. Phase one is where most people start. How many people, raise your card if you know what a phase one study is? Yay, okay, good. So phase one is many times your first-in-human studies. But also where I work, where a lot of the stuff that we study people take, we may be moving it into a new patient population, or we may be looking at a new formulation of it. And so in phase one studies, you usually have very few people involved. You may only put 1 to 3 people at a time on a given dose. Sometimes if it's something that you understand very well, you might put 15 people on at a time. But the idea is that it's very early. You're trying to see what the maximum tolerated dose is going to be typically. But it's very rare that, you know, I guess the best point that I was ever taught, one of the best points, was never enroll more people than you are willing to kill in a phase one study. That's a scary thought, but it's a very true one when you are dealing with really new substances that have never been put into human beings before. Phase two, you may have a phase 2A and a phase 2B. This is where we're trying to learn more and more about safety, and safety is an important element through all of these different types of trials. So we're trying to learn about safety. We're trying to also learn more about how these drugs or these interventions are working. How are they effective? Do we see a little bit about effectiveness? Sometimes in something called surrogate endpoints. So maybe I can't look at death, but I can look to see if the tumor is slowing in growth in an oncology study. Although I will say what we have seen over and over again is that tumor reduction really is not very well associated with long-term survival in cancer. But that is a common type of outcome you see in phase two. Phase three are these major efficacy studies. This is where you see a decision, do we think this intervention actually works? But in truth, we move into something called phase four. Phase four is larger population studies where you don't have nearly as tight of control on the inclusion-exclusion criteria, and things can be a lot more generalizable. We also move into something called dissemination and implementation research. Dissemination and implementation, I work a lot in health services, and we want to say we have this new intervention. Can everybody do it? Can my dad, who's not going to go to a research hospital, actually get this treatment? How is it going to behave? Is the doctor, is the nurse even going to want to do it? That's part of dissemination implementation research. Now, comparative or cost-effectiveness research is when we say, okay, I have multiple interventions, all of which I think, I'm going to put it in quotes, work. We think they're useful. I would go ahead, providers would be using this, but is drug A different than drug B? You know, which of the different depression drugs should I give a patient? Doesn't matter. I want to compare those drugs to each other. Or maybe one of them reduces costs. If I have this set of therapy versus another set of therapy, is it less expensive? Now, one of the big distinctions that Kopis and Lee put forward several years ago, they talk about observational studies, and I'll say really this is non-randomized studies compared to randomized studies. That if you have a non-randomized study, a lot of these studies are analyzed as if they were actually controlled randomized trials. But the assumption of randomness is really crucial for the inference and the validity of the inference. And so when you think about what we talk about in our hypothesis testing lecture, and you think about the reporting of results lecture that Dr. Joaquin will give, it's very important to understand and to think about whether you have an observational or a non-randomized study versus a randomized study. And that's something also Dr. Minnikoff will bring up, some of the mistakes that people make when they're trying to analyze studies. So what is this kind of quasi-experimental single-arm study or a non-randomized experimental study? You tend to have either no control group. It's early in the investigation. You put everybody on the intervention. You have a concurrent control group. Treatment assignment is not by randomization. So I say, well, all of my new patients, they are all going to get this drug. And the patients who don't want the new drug, I'm going to just watch them. I'm going to compare them to each other. There could be a real reason why some people are getting the new drug versus not. So these are problems with concurrent control groups. Historically controlled studies, and we used to do these a lot in pediatric oncology, you have missing data. So this is where I go and I say, I have a control group from another study, and I'm going to use their data to compare to my new patients. Or I have 15 years worth of data on the patients that have come to my clinic, and I'm going to use their clinical data, and I'm going to compare that to all of my new patients who I'm putting into this new drug, this new intervention. Well, I may not have collected the data I needed when I needed it on those former patients. Also, think about how your own practices, the medical interactions you've had, have changed even in the last 15 years. How you diagnose patients, when you diagnose them. There's a lot of additional information. These people are different and they're treated differently. And so paying attention to that can really cause problems. But sometimes you might not have the best comparable groups, but you think having some comparison is better than having no comparison. And so it's important not to say this is bad, throw it out, but instead to say we need to understand the limitations and think very carefully about what we want to do and not do. So we have basically our world broken into these non-randomized studies and randomized studies, at least when you're someone like me who's a statistician. The trick with non-randomized studies is you can only show associations. You cannot show causality here. There's also this trick, this word confounder is going to keep popping up for a while. You're not going to know all the different things that in fact could be actually showing that outcome. You think you know what has caused the outcome, but you don't actually know. Because there's all this stuff you haven't measured, there's all this stuff that maybe is actually causing the problem. So if I put a bunch of matches in my pocket, and I have lung cancer, so I can see an association of carrying matches or a lighter in pockets and lung cancer. Does that mean that the matches actually cause the lung cancer? Raise your card if you think matches cause lung cancer. Yeah. So this is confounding, folks. There's this unknown variable that we haven't measured or put in the model yet. It's called smoking, which is probably what the matches are for. That is the problem. So there's a classic example, and it's actually at the end of your notes, and this was published in New England Journal, and I give my Harvard colleagues credit. They did, in fact, try to put smoking into their model. So they looked at coffee drinking, and they found an association with drinking coffee, which I love dearly, and pancreatic cancer. Now, you would never assume if you had pancreatic cancer that you would decide to start drinking coffee. So you assume that the coffee is leading to pancreatic cancer, right? New York Times, worldwide news, coffee leads to pancreatic cancer. The problem is that I drink a lot of coffee. I do not smoke. But smoking and coffee drinking actually do go together, just like smoking and alcohol tend to go together. They are associated with each other. And it turns out that how they measured smoking was in such a way that they didn't see the association with pancreatic cancer. But subsequent studies showed that, in fact, the entire effect was because of smoking. And once you put smoking in a model with pancreatic cancer, coffee drinking was no longer associated with pancreatic cancer. That is confounding. It's not in the causal pathway, but it's kind of doing a really bad job of being associated. You're never going to know all your possible confounders. You're never going to get them measured. That's why we do randomized studies. So randomized studies, I can show association and causality. And a randomized study with a well-done non-adaptive randomization, this is going to become key when Paul starts talking to you, with a non-adaptive randomization, unknown confounders should not create problems. They do create problems in adaptive randomizations because they can throw off your randomization. So there are a lot of different types of randomized studies. We've got parallel groups, that's classic, that's those two or multiple arms happening simultaneously. Something that the engineers like called sequential trials. I'm not going to talk much about those except because they set up group sequential trials. These are very, very classic in the clinical literature. Group sequential trials are when you actually do something called interim analyses and you look at the data and you've planned this, I should say, and we're going to talk about the special ways you do it, but you look at the data and then you decide if you're going to continue the trial or not, based either because the results maybe look so promising you want to stop or so futile you want to stop. But remember, results can be deceiving, and sometimes you say maybe we should stop, but there's a good reason not to. So that's part of what we'll be talking about, but not in the next hour. Crossover designs. This is something that's important. We'll go through a couple of examples I worked on. But you have to have an intervention washout period. So whenever you see crossover design, the first thing you should ask is, can you wash out the interventions before you ask anything else? Factorial designs. These are very popular. Like, they'll talk about 2x2 factorial designs. However, you have to have independent interventions that you're working with. And I'll talk a little bit about that. Adaptive designs have gained popularity, but there are 20 plus different types of adaptive designs. I'll tell you about some key elements of those. We have enriched enrollment, which is regression to the mean central location, and then also cluster randomized designs. If you want to learn more about any of these, look in the book chapters, and we have a lot of examples in there. So in parallel group designs, what we're going to do is randomize patients to one of X different treatments. I might have two treatment arms, but I could have four or five different treatment arms. So I might randomize patients to either go to a yoga class, to go to aerobic exercise, to go to deep stretching, or go to a class that's going to teach them about low back pain. So this is, in fact, the design of one of the studies I worked on for chronic low back pain. Now, we want to measure a response after a period of time. We might measure this at the end of the study. We may look at the change over the period of time from baseline. You can also look at percent change from baseline, but that's fraught with a lot of problems. There are a lot of issues when you try to look at percent change from baseline, but some folks do. Sometimes I don't just want to measure them at the beginning of the study and the end of the study. I actually want to measure them multiple times. So I may want to take a measurement every 6 weeks, let's say, for a year. So if I'm going to do that, that's called repeated measures, and there are special analysis techniques for that. And also, I may be looking at something like, say, body mass index. So it might be a function of multiple measures, like height and weight. So the variations on parallel group designs. Sometimes we will do dose titration with multiple study arms. Sometimes I do dose escalation studies, and I have an actual control arm that I'm simultaneously randomizing to. Now, I will be honest with you, a lot of dose escalation, dose titration studies are not randomized. But this is a new trend, and I think a very important one that helps improve the rigor of research and stops a lot of interventions that maybe shouldn't be moving forward at a much earlier point in time. It's also important to have these control groups to really understand the safety. And when we get to Dr. Nathanson's lectures, this will come up again. But especially when I'm working, for example, I have a study in Huntington's disease. We're studying creatine, and part of what has come up is Huntington's disease patients, they have, you know, a lot of symptoms. They have a lot of depression, they have a lot of suicide, they also have a lot of falling issues and a lot of physical issues. So when I look at these patients, I need to figure out, is this because that they're having these issues because of the intervention? Are they having these issues just because of their normal course of disease? And without a control group, I can't figure that out. Because it's very easy for a doctor, as they look at their individual patient in my study, to say, of course, you know, they fell. What's the big deal? They fall. But I need to know, are they falling more often than I would have expected them to fall? This is the difference. So in sequential trials, we don't actually have a fixed sample size or period. You basically terminate when you're doing these constant tests for superiority. That's why people don't normally do these. But they do come up in engineering, so I bring them up because there's a whole special set of statistical design methods that, I'll be honest, most statisticians don't know how to do. So if you decide you want to do this, go find someone highly specialized, and they probably will have the word engineer somewhere in their name. Group sequential trials. These are very popular. You're going to analyze the data after certain proportions of the results are available. This is allowing for that early stopping. Again, if one treatment is clearly superior, if you see futility, or if you see certain adverse events. These require a lot of careful planning and statistical design up front. You're going to have some really great statisticians sitting on a data safety monitoring board probably looking at them when you do this. A crossover trial, I should go back and say the popular names you will hear around group sequential trials: Land-Demetz, O'Brien Fleming, Pocock, and Pito. They will be in the references that you will see. So crossover trials. The basic simple way of thinking of a crossover trial is that I am going to use each patient as their own control. So let's say I have two treatments. I need a two-period crossover. And what I'm going to randomize is which treatment a person gets first. Now the trick, as I said, is you have to eliminate carryover effects. I need a washout period between when people stop their first drug and start their second drug. So I study a lot of meditation. It's very hard. I can tell somebody to stop meditating. It's hard for them to unlearn meditation. So if we think they actually incorporate this into their lives, they don't stop it. It's like trying to tell an athlete to stop exercising. It doesn't work very well. Similarly, at an asthma study, the drug was supposed to actually change the cellular makeup inside of the lungs. And I said, well, if you've done that, you can't, how long does it take to undo that? They said, oh no, it doesn't change, it won't reverse, at least that's what we think. And I was like, well, you can't do a crossover study. I need to be able to reverse the effects. But sometimes this works, and especially you'll see people do it in certain diseases. But you have to think and you have to figure out what your washout period is going to be. You want some evidence on that. So a study I worked on was the women's alcohol study, and Dorgan et al. Published the initial paper on this at the Journal of National Cancer Institute in 2001. There also have been several publications afterwards. And what we did is we took postmenopausal women, and they had three dietary periods. So we randomized the order of assignment to three different alcohol levels. They got 30 grams a day of alcohol, which is about two drinks, 15 grams a day of alcohol, or 0 grams of alcohol. So this was a full feeding study. They came to our facility in Beltsville. They got their breakfast, they picked up a lunch, they came back, they got their dinner, and then they had a little snack to take at bedtime that was orange juice mixed with something. For those of y'all who know what it is, it was actually Everclear that we used. So they had washout periods, but we knew for alcohol how long it took to get rid of the physiological effects. Now, this is a really hard study. Imagine this. If you don't even count the washout periods, in fact, they are getting a very tightly controlled feeding study for half a year. So we actually had to make changes, and we said, oh, your daughter's getting married? Okay, we're going to extend the washout period so you can have some champagne at her wedding in order to allow this person to stay on the trial. Sometimes you have to make accommodations to your schedules. But this was a double-blind study. The women, we told them to drink this before they went to bed and not to drive, regardless of what they were doing. But the women were blinded. They supposedly didn't know what they were drinking. It was just an orange drink. The people who were doing all the measurements, all the investigators were blinded. The only people who knew what was going on were the people packing their little boxes there at the facility in Beltsville. And in fact, this study, they were interviewed for the local paper, and somebody said, yes, like, you know, I know, like, I feel drunk every night. And so the PI went to me and said, I really want to know when this woman was actually on her drinks. And she actually had only been on the placebo arm thus far when she gave the interview. So this is another thing to remember. Blinding can really work. That placebo effect can really take account. So what's a factorial design? This is another study I did with my colleagues at the National Cancer Institute, and we did this with a large group of cancer researchers in China. So in China, there's a huge issue, something called squamous cell carcinoma of the esophagus. This actually also is an issue here in Brazil at times. So what you do in a factorial design is that you take every level of your treatment and you mix it with every other factor. So we wanted to study selenomethionine and celecoxib. And what we did is people essentially got randomized to one of four arms here, right? So they're either gonna get selenium in a placebo form and celecoxib as a placebo form. So celecoxib is a COX-2 inhibitor. Then we have selenium placebo and real celecoxib, or they're gonna get real selenium and a celecoxib placebo, selenium, and celecoxib for real. So how does this work? Well, the main thing that you have to think about is there an interaction between selenium and celecoxib? So these are our factors, yes, no. And when I want to do my comparison, when I do my analyses, I forget the four arms in a factorial design. In a factorial design, I compare everybody who had selenium placebo to everybody who got the real selenium. And that's how I do my selenium test. I ignore the fact that they took any type of celecoxib, yes or no. In the factorial design, when I do my celecoxib, again, all the placebo against all the real. I ignore their selenium. So here's the question I put forward. Do I power this interaction? Is this really a four-arm study that I care about? Or is it essentially two-arm studies? The reason people like factorial designs is from a sample size perspective, you gain a lot of efficiency. They will essentially, and this is going to put it very incorrectly, but close enough, you essentially want to power the larger study. So whichever one requires the most sample size, whether it's selenium to no selenium, or whether it's celecoxib to no celecoxib, essentially that's the sample size you're going to use. And you already have all the infrastructure there, so you're getting kind of a two-for-one deal, right? Unless what you need to do is actually answer some really good information about all four arms of the study compared to each other, in which case this is a lousy deal for you. You need to power your study completely differently, even though it looks pretty similar. Now, there's actually a lot of information on the Penn State website. Linda Collins has done a lot of work thinking about kind of demystifying factorial designs and how you will do the sample sizes. So I can get you all the information for her website. It's very interesting to try to figure out how best to do these and how not. So they're good designs as long as you use them correctly. Ms. Flash is a study that NCAM and the National Institute of Aging just finished. And we had a factorial design here where we're looking at yoga, aerobic exercise, usual activity, and then either getting an omega-3 supplement or a placebo supplement. The reason I wanted to show you this study is because we actually did not equally randomize to all of the arms. Also, when you look at how Ms. Flash was designed and powered, they did not power to actually compare yoga to aerobic exercise. They only powered to compare aerobic exercise to usual activity and yoga to usual activity. Now, it did give us some preliminary information to power a future study that would compare yoga and aerobic exercise, but it does not, in this study with Ms. Flash, give us a definitive answer about that question. So sometimes we have too many arms to compare. So I worked on the nutritional intervention trial. This is actually still ongoing in China, where we had to do what was called an incomplete, some people call it a partial or a fractional factorial design. There is a lot of micronutrient deficit in China, especially in the 1980s when the study was first started. And what they did is they took four different groupings of micronutrients, and they said, we're not interested in all combinations of micronutrients, but we want to look at a certain set of them. So instead of looking at 16 combinations, we looked at about 8. And so, you know, 20 years later, do we wish that we chose some different combinations? Yes, I will be honest with you, we do. But we set up what types of comparisons, or others set up, what types of comparisons could be done. I got to live with them and analyze the data once I got to NCI. But the trick in these partial factorial designs is sometimes there's certain interactions that are just not of interest. And when we ran this study, we had 30,000 people in it. Our primary interest is the fact we didn't have enough people and enough money to test all of them. So we said, what's the most important thing to test? And that's what we're going to do. So what about these adaptive designs? These adaptive designs are gaining in popularity. A lot of them, some have two arms, many have 8 or more arms. A lot of times you see them in dose ranging studies. So what you'll see is they'll put 8 different doses up and try to stop certain dose arms early. Tend to have this identification in the medical literature that you will have a smaller sample size. But you may not. A trick behind adaptive designs is sometimes you end up with a larger sample size than you would have if you had done a non-adaptive design. But many times what we're going to do is we're going to basically run in, is what we call it. So you put a bunch of people on the study and you start to get their outcomes. Then after a little bit of time, you start analyzing data continuously or at fixed points. Now, somebody around this time should say, raise their hand and say, Laura Lee, didn't you say something about analyzing data at fixed points before? And in fact, some people will say that the group sequential designs is one type of an adaptive design. So, in fact, they act like that. You can close an arm early. Now, there are different ways that you can try to do this. You can either use baseline information to make adaptations, or you can use the outcome information from your early patients to make adaptations. But there are a lot of ways to mess this up. So you re-estimate the sample size. One of my favorite ways of doing this is actually looking at the variance. When you hear about sample size from Paul Joachim, what you're going to hear is that the variance is incredibly important to estimate your sample size. And a lot of times the variance of your outcome measure for each of your different study arms is the one thing we don't have a good measure of going into the study in your particular patient population. So you can take some of the early data and without a penalty actually re-estimate the sample size. But when you do that, you may have a larger sample size and you have to figure out a budget to deal with that. But a big negative about all these adaptive designs is as soon as you make a decision to continue a study, that information is provided to the study investigators, the public, and many times investors. There was a case of a company in the United States where their stock dropped by half when the decision was made to continue the study. They said, well, it wasn't good enough to stop early, so it must not be good. That's not the information you want to send. So you have to think, you know, if you stop a study, it's kind of done. You know, it's not as big of a deal. But whenever you have interim analyses and decide to continue, you're giving everybody in the world information about that study, even if you don't tell them at all about what you saw. So what's an enriched enrollment design? These are kind of some variant on crossover N of one studies at times. N of one studies is when you do a crossover multiple times inside the same person. It's probably the easiest way to explain it. Here in enrolled enrichment designs, we are trying to identify potential responders. So this is somebody that maybe responds to the drug, and then I say, okay, now I'm going to put them into the next study. Thank you. So the results are not generalizable to the entire patient population, but this can be a problem. So I have a study on statins. So statins cause problems with your muscles. You can have a lot of arthralgias, a lot of other issues. There is a natural product that people think if you take this, it will resolve these issues. Well, first we had to see if statins were actually causing these folks problems with their legs. So what we did is we put them into this run-in phase. They had statins, and we took them off the statins, and we put them back on the statins to try to see if we could induce and resolve and induce again the problems they were having with their muscles. Once they got through that phase and we realized that they were in fact having problems with their muscles due to the statins and not for other reasons, we then went forward and put them on the trial. The problem is that a lot of times people stop having problems. So I did a herpes study. We wanted to make sure that everybody had three occurrences that occurred, that happened within a year, 18-month period, and then they were allowed to enroll in the herpes study. Let me tell you, the fastest thing to keep people from having a herpes outbreak is to run them into that trial. They were like, the control arm, like nothing. Nothing was happening. It was awful. Well, it's great for them, but not good for me. So results are not going to be generalizable when you run these people in. You know, if I am a doctor and I just know that my patient is on statins and they're complaining of muscle problems, I'm not necessarily going to take them on and off drug to make sure it's really due from the statin. I'm just going to tell them to go take the supplement if that actually works out. So this is what's called regression to the mean. People tend to come to us when they are unhealthy, when they are having problems. And over time, these things tend to resolve. Dr. Minnikoff will talk about how time is such a wonderful confounder, and it tends to solve a lot of healthcare problems. So group or cluster randomized studies. Typically, when we talk about randomization, we're randomizing individual human beings. But in a group or a cluster randomized study, the unit of randomization might be the school or the physician or the community or the clinic. And I'm going to randomize them. So if I'm going to try to change eating patterns to impact obesity or other health measures or health outcomes, I may want to alter supermarket environments. I may want to start offering school-based nutrition programs. And when I do that, I have to randomize a community that will get that, not individual people. Because the little kid is going to come home and tell them what they learned at school, and that's going to probably impact what the older brother is going to be eating, or so we hope. Now, there's some of our interventions that are really at that higher system level, and there's sometimes that I can't tell a doctor to treat a patient one way and the next patient a different way, and they say, but it looks good, so I want to treat them the same way. Or it looks bad, so I don't want to treat them either way. These are when you tend to go to cluster randomized studies. There's a great study, actually, that was done through the Poverty Action League out of MIT. And what they did, everybody said for malaria, you had to charge for bed nets because people had to be invested in using their bed nets. So this group of young investigators went out and they said, well, what if you just give them out for free? And so what they did is they actually randomized healthcare centers that were far enough away from each other that they knew the women were not going to go to the different healthcare centers. And they had it set up that women who were pregnant were going to actually get free bed nets, or they had differential pricing at the different centers. And what they then did is they compared, and a lot of studies had said, what happens if what I do is just, do they use the bed net? And they said, no. What we care about is infants getting malaria. This is what we care about. That is our outcome measure. And what they found was, in fact, giving out the free bed nets reduced infant malaria cases. But then what they also found when they started walking around and visiting places is that these bed nets actually took up the entire household. So this is taking up the entire living structure, and people were decorating them and making them look pretty. So their next study, in fact, they gave out pretty bed nets versus non-pretty bed nets. I'm not kidding you. It was actually pretty amusing to look at this gal's pictures. And what they found was, you know, they also found that the instructions weren't very good. So one of the issues that came up was that they were not putting them up correctly. Well, some people thought that was a bad thing, and they said, well, how do we fix it? So this is how you can evolve your studies, is a lot of times you have to challenge what everybody thinks is true. And in fact, I would say that's an important element of research. When you are doing research, you have to figure out those things that you hold most sacred. What is the level of evidence that's needed to make you realize that that's not a good idea anymore? These are the types of things we have to think about in our research. So what goes into a good study design? We've talked a little bit about designs. Study aims. What is it that you want to do in your study? What is the background? You know, what do we know about these bed nets and malaria and about cost structures? What do you know? What's already been done? And what's the rationale for doing your study? What are the endpoints, the outcome variables, and all those other assessments that you want to take? So what are the specific assessments that you're going to do? Because sometimes it's not an outcome variable, but it's a variable I need to be collecting all the way across. You know, suicidality, depressed mood. I'll be honest, in my Huntington's disease study, these are not outcome variables that we have. But they're very important variables I need to track all the way through. And these are questions that the providers and that honestly the caregivers for these patients are going to be asking me about. So this is my ruler. I got this free ruler at a meeting on statistics. You need to be very careful about how, not only what variable are you measuring, don't tell me you're measuring sleep. Do not tell me you are measuring sleep. Tell me exactly how you are measuring sleep. Are you measuring the minutes until they fall asleep? Do you use some type of sleep quality index? But if you're measuring waist circumference, this ruler right here is a bad thing to use. It is a very fine ruler, but it is not going to be specific or sensitive to the changes in my waist. You have to have a different way of doing the measurement. You have to think about the reliability and the validity of the measure and how that actually pertains to your population. There are a lot of measures of depression, a lot of self-report measures. Many of them do not work well in older populations because, in fact, what they're really measuring is pain and sleep issues. And so you have to actually think if the measure you're going to use is useful in the population you're trying to use it in. Inclusion-exclusion criteria. One of the big troubles that come up is that you need to measure, everybody's running your study needs to decide if that single person should be in or should be out. They need to be able to make the same decision every time. And when I go forward and want to repeat your study, I want the exact same ability to be able to understand whether somebody should be in or out of the study. You need to think about accrual plans, folks. How do you get people in? Inclusion-exclusion criteria are great, but you do not want to exclude everybody in the world from your study. Where are you going to find people? How are you going to bring them in? This is a really important part of accrual planning. Your preparatory tasks. You have to think about these poor human beings. They're going to be in your study. They may go to work and not necessarily want to show up between 9 a.m. and 4 p.m. to give you blood Monday through Friday. So think about the timeline not only for your overall study, but for each of the individual study participants. You have to plan this into your planning, because sometimes people tell me, I'm going to enroll 30 patients a year. They have 5 years to do, actually usually they have 4 years to do their enrollment. So I've got 4 years to do enrollment. They tell me I'm enrolling 30 patients a year. They have to be on study for 1 year. And I need 400 patients. And I say, you can't finish in time. You need to figure out a way to get more than 30 patients a year into your study, or you need to run a different study. So you have to think about this in advance. What about the treatments? What are the participant implications? I have a study I'm looking at right now that has a light box. So people cannot have any photosensitive types of drugs that they're taking. That includes several antibiotics and a variety of other drugs. So we have to talk to them about what drugs they can and cannot use while they're on study. We also have to think about exactly how do you measure the light coming out of a box. So what is the product? What is the actual dose? What is the quality? You know, Dr. Gallen mentioned the issues of drug quality and purity. Are they actually getting the same thing every time? If somebody does another study, can they actually replicate what that drug is? And that includes your placebo, your supposed placebo or control drug. What is the administration? Is it IV? Is it oral? I had a probiotic study. They were mixing the probiotics with Kool-Aid so little kids would drink it. It turns out that that live probiotic died in 3 seconds of being in the Kool-Aid. So then the investigator went from trying to tell me why live probiotics were important to telling me that the dead probiotics were okay and would also be useful. So you have to think about the reproducibility of the interventions and training. Like I said, I work on a lot of these different yoga studies, I work in a lot of different places, and you have to make sure that intervention is delivered the same way all the way through the trial, and that you can train other people on how to do this. This is also a huge issue in all behavioral interventions. So what is the dose? I'm going to focus a little bit on this because I have a lot of discussions with investigators. I basically spend most of my life doing things that I was never originally trained to do, but I found actually impact the analyses and the study designs I work on so much, I had to become an expert in all of this too. So I thank everybody who helped train me in this. Think about, you know, we think about dose, you think probably about milligrams, right? You think about the part in a pill. But also think about the treatments. How many sessions are people taking? Or if they are taking a 100 milligram tablet, are they taking it once a day, twice a day? Are they taking it in the morning with food? What is the amount that they are taking and when? How long does it last in their system? But similarly, if I'm trying to send out text messages to try to convince people not to smoke, when do I send them? How frequently do I send them? At what point does it cause more harm and they're irritated by it than it causes good? When I try to do my yoga classes, do I go once a week, twice a week? Do I go for 30 minutes, for an hour? Do I go for 8 weeks? Do I go for 12 weeks? Do I go for 8 weeks 3 times a week? And then I go once a week for the rest of my life? What is it that you do? All of these are different doses. And I will tell you, you will never find the optimum dose, but you can look at a variety of doses and try to figure out some of which don't work, see if some are too much, or if some seem reasonable, or if nothing seems to work and nobody will take any more of it. So when we move to maximum tolerated doses, well, when I worked in oncology, a lot of times we had people that were projectile vomiting. Now I have people who say, I'm not swallowing all those pills. I'm not going to yoga 7 days a week. That's kind of when I'm finding my maximum tolerated dose. It's also that they just won't do it anymore. So you have to think about all of these different elements. You also have to think about who's doing the work. So think about surgery. If you were going to have surgery, if one of your loved ones is going to have surgery, who do you want to do that? surgeon probably really matters, doesn't it? Or will you just have anybody do your open heart surgery? Surgeon matters. Same thing if you're going to go and have a psychologist do your therapy, if you're going to have a massage therapist do work. How much contact time are these folks going to have in your studies? Who is that person? And what are their impacts on outcomes? So when I run a study that has kind of a group element to it, I need to have a leader, or I'm going to have the intervention as a group-based or a person-based intervention. First, you need backup, because if that person dies or gets sick, somebody's got to carry on. But you actually want multiple practitioners involved. You want to get an idea of the generalizability and find out, is it just this one person who's really good at doing what they do and they can always pull it off? Or is it in fact that multiple people can actually execute this intervention? So there are a lot of different combinations going into dose, but we have to think about all of them. We also have to think about our intervention definition. Again, the replication. When you write your protocol and when you write all of your manuscripts, you're going to have to say why you chose the doses that you chose. You're going to have to talk about interference with patient management, like those poor patients that now can't take certain antibiotics, and we have to figure out a way to talk to their doctors in case they're going to be prescribed them. You also have to think about generalizability versus specificity. Sometimes we want to do something called a proof of concept study. Sometimes we want to look at a very small patient population, and we want to look with the very best surgeon or the very best massage therapist, the really great psychologist, and we want them to perform the intervention. And when they perform it, if it fails, we're done. If they can't make it work, nobody's going to make it work. If you can't make it work in this patient population, why am I going to go to a much broader patient population? But realistically, for most of our work, we actually want it to be generalizable. And so I'm constantly struggling how early to have generalizability. Personally, I now do it early because I'm tired of having very small, precise studies that then blow up later on. But not everybody feels the same way. You need to specify the criteria to withdraw people from your studies. And also when to just say, you know what, there was a deviation from protocol. So a lot of times you will hear us say, once randomized, always analyzed. When somebody's randomized into your study, you keep collecting data on them as long as you're not going to harm them by collecting the data. Maybe I cannot intervene on them, but I can at least actually collect data on them. Because isn't that like real life? Realistically, you tell patients to do something, and my doctor tells me to do something, I may or may not do it. That's real life. That is in fact part of what you're looking at. But sometimes you say, yes, this is risky, and I've got to take them out. You also want to list all the concurrent medications, the procedures that they're going to be taking, what's prohibited for them to do. You want to let them know that. And what's permitted and how to record certain things. It's like we talked about some of these practitioner impacts. There could be positives and there can be negatives. But it's a really important way to think about who's interacting with your patients and what else could be causing the outcomes in your study. Sometimes we do these mechanistic proof of concept studies. You're going to throw your best at it. You're only going to actually look sometimes at those that I call the well-behaved. So this is per protocol analyses. Or you're like me, and I say general use. I want to know how this is going out the door and everybody's using it. And this is something called intent to treat analyses. But it all comes down to what is your question? Are you trying to know only how the well-behaved react or not? So intent to treat, like I said, includes all of the randomized patients. You assume that all study participants actually did what you told them to do. I do not care that the pharmacy sent them the wrong drug. You assume they adhered to the study regimen I assigned them and that they completed the study. Modified intent to treat analysis is kind of similar. It's intent to treat, But it only includes people usually that started the intervention they were assigned to. But what could happen here? Maybe they don't like what they were assigned to and they dropped out. So as soon as you do modified intent to treat, you have biases in your patient population samples. Some of the pharmaceutical companies now are moving modified intent to treat that people have to actually stay in the study until the first time that they give response data. Again, you're actually ending up, you've kind of broken your randomization at this point. I'm not going to say it wasn't even worthwhile to randomize, but a lot of my friends would. The completers or the adherers analysis. These are the people that did exactly what you told them to do, and they gave you all of their data. And do we really think those folks are representative of the general population? Probably not. But this is what we're talking about. Now, some studies say, well, completers did 75% of the yoga workouts, something like that. But realistically, a lot of times we don't know which dose is so important, how much is important to really define what complete is. Many times people start to feel better and they stop taking the drug. Probably everybody in this room has done that. You start to feel better and you stop your intervention. So a little bit more vocabulary here. You have a study arm, a sample, a group. A lot of times we want to do something called demonstrating superiority, so detecting a difference between the treatments, the study arms, and the groups. Or we want to demonstrate that something is equally effective. This is called an equivalence trial. Now, statisticians, we're very happy with uncertainty. However, I can never tell you that two things are exactly equal until I measure it on everybody in the world. Since that will not happen, we have to kind of put a little caveat around it and talk about equivalence, not equal. Sample size is really big to try to determine equivalence. We also have something called non-inferiority. Now, these bottom two designs, there's some articles that you all should have gotten on that secure site out of New England Journal of Medicine from 1997. There's a big controversy about one of the studies that tried to actually say they had non-inferiority, and the editorial group said, no, you didn't. In fact, you had a superiority trial, and you failed to reject the null hypothesis. So what is superiority? What is equivalence? So superiority means you're way out here on the outside. So let's say this middle is no difference between the arms. Superiority means the difference between the arms is either really high or it's going in the opposite direction. This is down when you know maybe my placebo arm is much, much better than that new treatment. Equivalence or no difference, I need the confidence interval that we're going to talk about tomorrow. I need that confidence interval to fit inside this little blue box. So I'm going to put a little areas around. So let's say I have a cough suppressant. I'm giving you a liquid to try to make it so that you're not coughing at night. Well, I can't say that this generic new cough syrup works as well as the one that's already on the market, exactly as well. But I can say, you know, plus or minus a certain number of coughs overnight, it probably works about the same. That's what this range, this equivalence range is. Non-inferiority is a little different. Non-inferiority is when I want to say, well, it might be better, or it might be a little acceptable amount worse. So typically, this is nowhere near where I would say, well, it's definitely worse. So let's say, you know, 3 coughs per hour. Do you really notice 3 coughs per hour? If you're coughing a lot, probably not. So you may have, I could say, well, maybe people cough 2 or 3 times more per hour. That's acceptable. That may be non-inferior. Similarly, let's think about survival. If I said that, you know, you have lung cancer, so you're going to survive for a while. If I said, you know, I gained you 1 or 2 days of life, comparing lung cancer treatments, you may say that's not all that consequential. Like, you know, at the end of life, you may say, I want those days. But really, on average, in populations, you know, instead of you're really thinking about months, 1 to 2 days, that's going to be what you care about. That's non-inferiority. And by the way, this curve that I have here, this is called a normal distribution or a Gaussian curve. So what are these comparison groups? Because I keep talking about controls or placebos. So you tend to have some type of experimental intervention versus some type of control group. Maybe an active control, maybe a non-active control. But as Jerry's going to talk about this afternoon, sometimes I have cases and I have controls. And sometimes I'm going to have exposed individuals and unexposed individuals. Sometimes I'm going to have different levels of exposure that I'm comparing to each other. I could also be comparing men to women. I could be comparing my young and my old, different types of weights, body mass index, standard of care. I could be comparing people that I have historical data on, or I could be using my own historical data. I could be using pre, so my baseline data compared to post, my follow-up data. So let's talk about placebo pills, standard of care, and attention controls. So in an experimental treatment, you might be just receiving supportive care. For example, in a lot of those early HIV/AIDS trials, people said, it's not that we do nothing for patients. We may not have the type of intervention that you all think is going to be curative or extending life, but we think we are doing something. We're balancing their fluids and electrolytes. We're maintaining oxygen status and blood pressure. We're treating them for complicating infections. We're giving them antimalarials. We do something. Sometimes you're giving current treatment. Those may be what your comparison arms are. When we did our yoga studies, Karen Sherman was looking and she said, well, it might be the exercise, it might just be deep stretching. That was one of her comparison arms. Sometimes we say that the attention, the time and attention you spend in class or just being in a group environment may matter. So I may send them to cooking classes. Why do I send people to cooking classes? Because they're in a group, so if they're going to pick up new diseases and see people, that's fine. There's a group element, but they don't talk to each other much. They're just doing what they're supposed to be doing and following the instructor. I really love cooking classes as a control group for my behavioral studies and my exercise studies. Book clubs also, they talk to each other, so this is different, but if I'm also comparing it to a group environment where they are going to talk to each other, book clubs can be useful. Also very popular and cheap. So honestly, if somebody's going to go to a meditation class and spend $400 US on that, and they can go to their public library for a free book club and get the same type of impact, I'm pretty happy for them to go to book club. And sometimes it's nothing. Sometimes it's a waitlist control, so they are waiting to actually go in to the interventional arm, so it's sometimes called a delayed start. We do a similar type of delayed start in a lot of vaccine studies. But remember, sometimes nothing at all can be your best intervention. And it's always, always an option, for your patients at least. So what are we going to do here? Remember, the amount of control you have, it is going to cost money, and it is also going to cost you in sample size. When somebody says that they want to actually look, they want to look at the smallest element of difference between their study arms, I usually tell them, please do not do this. You really, everything that's different between your control arm and your intervention arm is going to drive the outcome in your study. But if you have not studied something before, you probably want a big difference. You want a proof of concept. And then you can start figuring out if one little tiny element of your 15-part intervention is actually the secret sauce that makes it work. So you can really end up with some very low power if you're not careful. So again, what are these control groups? Placebo, so you give them a sugar tablet, although be careful because people can figure out that from their blood work sometimes, as somebody who gave 40 grams of glucose to folks as a control group once. Most widely accepted treatment. That's something else that you have to consider. What is standard treatment? Don't tell me standard treatment. Don't tell me usual care. Record exactly what every single provider is doing so you know what they are doing, especially if you have a long-term study. Standard of care is going to change. Usual care is going to change, or at least how they are providing it will change over time. You want that data to analyze it when you're looking at it. What is the most accepted prevention intervention that could be done? If you're looking at HIV, people talk about condoms. We have various types of prevention elements that you may want to use for other studies. What is the most accepted means of detection or diagnostic test? Again, when we were looking at that cervical cancer, it was trying to do the pap smear. Now, sometimes diagnostic tests are not gold, they're kind of bronze, but still, that's something that you need to consider. And sometimes we use non-disease populations and we're comparing our disease populations to try to make them look closer to a non-diseased population. So these randomized groups, they have to be ethical. When somebody goes into a study, all I know, what I assume, is that you all have set up the inclusion and exclusion criteria so I can put that person in any arm of your study. And if you don't allow that, I will put them on a study arm that could kill them because I don't know any better. I have set up a computer to do this work, and so you have to decide up front what are the inclusion and exclusion criteria for the study so that anybody can go to any arm of the study. Another element that people always ask me, so I now put it on the slide, they say, don't you have to be able to blind your control arm? And I say, no. One of my favorite studies I worked on actually compared an IV antibiotic to a pill of the same medication. We were trying to give it to little kids who actually were getting their dialysis at night. The whole reason they got dialysis at home at night was so they could go play in the fields and go pick up a bunch of diseases while they were sliding in on their baseball games. So they would get dirt, they'd get infections. Well, if I had to go hook them up to IV antibiotics every afternoon, it kind of defeated the purpose. But if you don't have a placebo group, you're going to have a lot of problems. People do tend to do better getting any type of care. Supportive care matters, and you want to take that into account when designing your studies. You want to compare your population incidence rate at the beginning of a program to the end. You may look, in fact, even really bad, but if you had a comparison group, you're looking a heck of a lot better than you could have. So you really have to think, especially for patients that are getting sicker, when crises are getting worse, your intervention may be helping you, but you're not going to see it if you just look before and after. So a lot of other problems come up. People forget to blind studies. They don't do randomization. You can see a lot of issues. So what's the right control group? There is no appropriate control group that will be good for every single study that you try to run. I'm sorry, I wish I could tell you differently, but I'm wrong. Jerry will talk about a lot of the different types of control groups you can have in your case control studies. You're going to also have to learn about time. If I have a new intervention for colds, I trust you that if I wait 7 to 10 days, that intervention will always work. It's going to be great. So you have to think about the fact that also people may drop out at different points in time. How are you going to account for that in your analyses? How are you going to account for the fact that one arm has exercise and one arm doesn't? What are the types of things that can throw off your results? Also, you need to think about when to measure those results. Do you know kind of when your differences are going to be changing? Do you know when they're going to peter off and it doesn't matter anymore that you're going to those yoga classes? What are you going to do with the delayed response? So there's masking and blinding. It's a lot less common in non-randomized studies, but many times I'll still mask the outcome assessors as to the hypotheses that they are looking at, even in my observational studies. So that way they don't dig a little extra when they're talking to certain patients and certain people. Specify who's supposed to be masked, why and how you're masking them, and to what. Doesn't mean that everybody has to be masked to everything, but you can probably do a decent job of this. You want to assess the criteria for unmasking the study, And you also want to figure out who needs to be unmasked. This is a need to know basis. It's like playing secret agent. If I sprain my ankle, actually, let's do it. I break my ankle. I have to go in for surgery. The anesthesiologist needs to know what drug I'm taking on this study. The pharmacist that is in charge of unblinding this information needs to be able to tell the anesthesiologist what drug I'm taking. I don't need to know what drug I'm taking. The provider doesn't need to know what drug I'm taking, like my general doctor doesn't need to know. The PI doesn't need to know what drug I'm taking. The anesthesiologist, he or she needs to know what drug I'm taking, so it, in case it interacts with what they want to give me. These are the things you need to think about with blinding. Reproducible measurement. Make sure that everybody, again, that you can measure everything in the same way. All of your study conduct, all the study outcomes, all of the data. When I write analysis plans now, I can put them up on the web so everybody can rerun my analyses. You want a well-defined cohort? How are you defining it? How are you measuring people to decide they're in or out of your study? But the other thing to remember is that nothing is perfect. There's always volunteer bias. There's inclusion-exclusion criteria issues that come up. The measures, you know, I can measure your pack per day smoking. I can measure ever-never smoker. I'm never going to probably measure it perfectly. I can try to do well, however. We also, you know, there are a lot of artificial interventions and treatment definitions, but again, try your best to make them as good and usable as possible. So Maria and Andre, do we have maybe 3 minutes for conclusions or should we go to lunch now? 3 minutes is fine. All right, someone time me. I'm timing myself. Okay. So you may need to rewrite your question. I told you your question comes first, but really, we may have to edit it and change it along the way. Because at the same time, if you change your question and you don't tell your statistician and other folks, you may not have the power to run your study, you may not have the data to run your study. But before everything happens, as you're finalizing that question, know your population. Know the group that you're working with. Try to have some pilot data about what you're doing. I want you to consider all the questions that you want to ask and the hypotheses and the tests that you want to look at, but think about all those key factors that you want to control. Think about those ethical issues and constraints, and we're going to talk a lot about that this week. I also want you to be thinking about, if you have different control groups, what can be said with those control groups? And many times, you want more than one control group. Many times, what you want is to have, you know, maybe you want an exercise control for that yoga study in Ms. Flash. Maybe I want a wait list with no exercise going on, because they're going to tell me different answers. But all of that information is necessary for the general public and for their clinicians and healthcare providers to make a decision about what to do. You want to have protocols that you write that people understand what you're doing. You want the training programs for the staff to be really clear, and all of your study staff, that includes all the instructors that may be involved in a study. It includes all your pharmacists and all the people that are making those pills for you. This is all part of your protocol. You need to be very clear who's in the study, who's not in the study, how you're taking the measurements. You want me, your statistician, to be able to go in and run your study without knowing anything. It should be that clear. What's going to be done, by whom, when? Are you going to be able to change it any? Somebody walks in and their leg is broken and they're supposed to fill out a physical functioning questionnaire that talks about running and walking. How do they do that? Do they do it? It needs to be clear what to do in various instances, and if you don't know, who to ask to find out and to make a decision. Oops, wrong one. So I'm going to stop here. See, I did take just exactly 3 minutes. And we're going to talk about confounding and effect modification sometime over the next week. All right, thanks a lot and enjoy lunch.